are the people at the BBC?
Big questions
direct from the Wondersmith Foundation opposite the Hammersmith flyover in London. This is the badly funded think tank with your host, Rich Holmes!
I think that was a little over the top.
Not at all, no. I thought they wanted that. I gave them that, and that's what they get. And by God, it's going to get good from here.
Well, hi, everyone. I'm Rich Hall. I'm American. Sorry for everything. There you go. No more sympathy, please. We've got all we need. And no more tribute albums. Certainly not any Michael Jackson attempting to address the problem. Obviously, there should be some way that one of these wayward missiles could hit Neverland. I'm just saying. This show has one purpose, ladies and gentlemen, to do the worrying for you. You people work hard. You don't have time to worry about so many things. And with this well-equipped staff and research facilities, we're pretty much on top of world events. We raise questions. We provide answers. That's what a think tank does. Granted, most of our previous findings and research have only been available by brochure. You might have seen some of our findings on your windscreen. However, with the purchase of this giant big screen TV, look at that bad boy. We have the audiovisual capabilities to go global, ladies and gentlemen, or certainly cable. I'd like to introduce you to my staff. That's him, Mike Wilmot. He's the chief curator for this show, and he's crammed with facts, figures, knowledge. He's got the CV to back it up. Tell us about your CV, Mike.
Well, I'm Canadian.
Well, enough said.
Also, I've done some of these think tank shows before.
These think tank
think
shows?
Think tank shows, yeah.
So this is not even an original idea?
For you, possibly.
Right. When you say you've done a lot of these think tank shows before?
Yeah, well, there was Think Along with Mike. Remember that one? Everything but the kitchen sink.
Thinks for the memories.
Yeah. Pink think.
Pink that think.
Was, yeah, that was a gay thing that I... More of an experiment, really.
So you're well-known in Canada.
Oh, huge.
Yeah.
Everywhere.
Household name.
Yeah.
All right, let's get right to the meat and potatoes of this, ladies and gentlemen. September 11th, yeah, no question that the world changed on that day, and certainly no good can come from any of this, obviously, except for the fact that maybe George Bush knows where things are on the planet now. Let's be honest, the man had no clue before that. Been out of the country 4 times, twice to Mexico to get a taco. Man once called people from Greece Grecians. Scary part about that, it's not a joke. The week before September 11, he was actually threatening to send troops into Celine Dion. Then 2 weeks ago, he went to China, actually visited China, apparently haven't forgotten that only 2 months ago he was staring them down, 2.5 billion Chinese. Give us our spy plane back, China. Give it back, or I'll find you on the map. Sophisticated piece of technology with a crew of 28, by the way. I mean, what kind of spy plane has 28 spies on board? Like a spy charter flight. Keep your eyes open, fellas. Let me know if you see anything down there. Oh, they're counterfeiting Springsteen albums, Captain. Man's got a very good staff, ladies and gentlemen. You got to hand that to him. They're quick to brief him on this whole thing because he's a little foggy there. It's Osama, George.
Who?
Osama bin Laden, one of your number one terrorists.
Who?
He's a millionaire, but he lives in a cave. Does he drive a Batmobile? Not gonna be that easy this time, all right? You don't get me wrong, you know, I support my president as much as the next person. I just think there's a little, you know, I support him as much as the next man. Whoever that is. Who is the next man? Mike.
What?
The next man.
Pardon?
You know that phrase, the next man, when they say, oh, I like so-and-so as much as the next man. Who are they talking about?
I'll look that up.
Good for you. It's Mike Wilmot on the ball, ladies and gentlemen. So I guess the question that Americans seem to be asking themselves the most at this point is, why would this happen to us? What? We got more snacks than anybody on the planet. Not afraid to use them. Why would they do this to us? So what conclusion have Americans come to about themselves? Well, we decided to ask. This is from America. Why does everybody hate us? Why do so many people hate the United States?
I heard somebody on TV this afternoon say it's because we had cable TV, but I don't think so.
And that's right. CIA stuff, so you don't want to get too close to it.
No. You're in touch with the CIA.
Fucking A.
You know the CIA?
Yes, I do.
They're going to go after Osama bin Laden. What do you think about that?
Who?
Osama bin Laden.
Already took care of him.
They already took care of him?
Yeah. Already gone.
You have inside information on this?
I ordered it.
You ordered it?
You fucking had it.
You ordered the assassination of Osama bin Laden?
Correct.
And it's been carried out?
Already, yep.
Oh, that's kind of an exclusive.
Some people that are just like whack, you know, bin Laden is whack in the head and he needs to get over himself and somebody needs to, you know, do something about him.
He's got a big ego?
Yeah.
The other day I saw someone out the back of their truck and they had bin Laden hung in effigy. It brought a salt tear to my eye, you know, yeah. I saluted, you know.
I mean, when it all boils down to it, we're all human beings and we're all people. I have friends that are Saudi Arabian.
Sorry.
Yeah, we're not dogs. I mean, if we could just sit there and scratch and lick ourselves and lay on our bellies, you know, I mean, then we'd all be happy probably and we'd all be, you know, we'd all get along, but we're not, so.
Should we lay on our bellies? You and me? You want
to... My opinion, they ought to start at one side of the border and work their way all the way across. And just annihilate the entire country.
All right, I'm rubbing my belly. I don't feel any freer. Do you feel any freer? Why do so many people hate Americans?
We love Americans.
No, you love America.
We're from Canada.
Oh, you heard of Mike Wilmot?
No,
whiskey bad. Have you ever heard of Mike Wilmot? No.
That's two people. That's two people.
I thought you were a household name.
It's Canadian show business. I mean, if bin Laden really wants a place to hide, I suggest Canadian show business. He'll never find it. He can have the, oh, look, I'm over here show. No one will give a shit.
Why does anybody have any ill will against Canada?
Well, no one really cares. I mean, we live next door to America, in the snow, amongst the French. If you want to come over, you know, bring a shovel.
Thanks, Mike.
Oh, and by the way, Richard.
Yeah?
I found out who the next man is.
Yeah?
Yes. Here he is here.
It's a fat guy drinking from a hose pipe.
Well, yes, but he's also Horst Brunner, and as designated by the International Bureau of Calculations and Measurements in Geneva, Switzerland, he's the man which all human activity is judged by.
That guy?
That's him, Mr. Middle of the Road Horst.
How do we know that?
Name something you like.
Cheesy Watsits.
Cheesy Watsits. Cheesy Watsits. It says right here, he had Cheesy Watsits. He had them in Blackpool in 1979.
Yeah.
He sampled three and found them quite satisfactory. But, you know, he wasn't fanatical about them. You know, he just liked them as much as himself. I'll
do an
anthrax sweep.
That's a good idea. America's economy is basically based on two things. We make lots of snacks, and we make lots of late-night exercise equipment. Get the world fat, then we help them to lose weight again. It's a vicious economic cycle. You know, I mean, turn on TV, cable TV. Right after this show, in fact, there'll be a half-hour infomercial about the biggest piece of shit exercise equipment you've ever seen in your life. It's the Ab Crunch Spectacular! You can have a washboard stomach and who gives a fuck? It's a washboard stomach. What, are you gonna play hillbilly bluegrass music right on your stomach there? It's some Cajun Zydeco, whack, 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 whack. It's shit! It's $29.95. Flip it over, it's a canoe. You can have it by tomorrow. Of course you can, because it's a big piece of crap. That's what we do in America. We make lots of shit, but we deliver it really fast. Good things come to those who wait, but shit pretty much shows up right away. That leads me to this. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the humanitarian daily ration. This is what we're dropping on the heads of Afghans from 20,000 feet. Lunch. Says right here, gift from the people of the United States of America. Gift. It's a gift. Pretty sure gifts don't fall on your head from 20,000 feet. Santa Claus bothers to come down the chimney. Anyway, when you open this up, I don't think anybody has actually bothered to figure out what the Afghans like to eat. You'd think there might be lamb chops or stew. Nope. These are the ingredients of the humanitarian daily ration. Freeze-dried red beans and rice. Crackers. And because the Scots want to make a valuable contribution, shortbread. This is everything a four-year-old Jamaican child would eat, not an Afghan. And here's my favorite, the moist towelette. The Afghans may be starving, but at least they're dainty. It says right here in three different languages, French, Spanish, and English, do not eat. Pretty sure, given the fact there's been a three-year drought, this would be the first thing you'd want to pop in your mouth in Afghanistan. A little mouth-watering towelette entree. It's crazy. What are you doing?
I'm checking for anthrax.
What have you got on your face?
Well, Richard, it's common knowledge if you don't want to inhale anthrax, you dip a handkerchief in urine, and then you breathe through the urine, and you won't get the anthrax.
It's supposed to be your own urine. Not anybody's urine. You're supposed to put your own urine on your face.
But in a perfect world. But
yeah. You've got a face full of somebody else's urine, Mike.
It's important. It just has to be urine. Any general urine does.
God, that's scary. Let's talk about the Taliban. How tough are they? Well, we know them to be excellent marksmen. Look at the way they shot up this 300-foot Buddha. Boom. Room service. So they certainly know their way around a rocket launcher from 100 yards away, 300-foot target. So if you happen to be a 300-foot soldier, cover your ass. They also own a huge arsenal of weapons, rocket launchers, missiles, most of them purchased from the Russians in the late 70s. So they're clearly rusty enough to carry some threat of tetanus or blood poisoning. Now, how does that stack up against the U.S.-British arsenal? Well, look at that. Look at the size of those soldiers. There's no way they can hide. They're bigger than the Buddhas. We've got two nuclear submarines. We've got about 600 fighter jets. We've got AWACS surveillance equipment, possibly 40,000 ground troops. And Britain's contribution is, of course, the GBU-28 Deep Throat JDAM Bunker Buster Bomb. You know that's huge just to get all the wording on it. Apparently, it can drill a hole 20 feet into the ground and then carve out an area half the size of a football pitch. Another term for that might be a cave maker. Every time we bomb the place, we're making more homes for Osama bin Laden. What the hell? Very lovely. It's Osama bin Laden Estates. And we drop in some interior decorating bombs.
Sure. Throw an Afghan over the couch.
You ever heard of Mike Wilmot?
No.
But is it enough? Well, thank God for the addition of these 3,000 Northern Alliance troops. That should pretty much tip the balance in our favor. These horses can kick up a hell of a dust storm. And as so many of the world leaders and military spokesmen have said, this is going to be a long and arduous task. That's why it's called Operation Enduring Freedom. Enduring Freedom. Let's all say that once. Enduring Freedom.
Enduring there. Freedom.
Don't you feel better about yourself? Yeah, the military in the United States debated for over 3 days on what to actually call this. No, it's infinite justice. No, it's eternal justice. It's infinite. It's eternal, fuckface. No, it's infinite. It's eternal. Infinite. Eternal. Then Steven Seagal called up and said, come on, I own the titles to both of those. So now it's enduring freedom. And whose job is it at the military to actually sit around and think up the titles for these military operations? Why don't they just go down to the perfume counter at a department store and pick out a name? Hot Afghan Nights by Ralph Lauren. Yeah, that'll work. Call it what it is. Operation Find the Fucker Before He Crop Dust My Backyard with Anthrax. How about that? Look, I don't have anything against fundamentalism. If that's what you want to believe, fine. But you don't have to take over planes and blow stuff up, America. We have fundamentalist religions in America.
True.
The people who live without electricity, they've got beards. They're called Amish. You don't see them taking over a plane. This is Obadiah. I'm Ebenezer. I have a butter churn. Back off! You know, it's just that we're not going to find this guy. Not right away. And surely there must be some thugs somewhere in Afghanistan, some heroin smugglers, Russian mafia, somebody, some sort of Islamic version of a Huggy Bear. Yes.
I've come across some interesting facts here. Historically, bad guys have been short and good guys have been tall.
Really?
Yes. Hitler was short, Mussolini shorter. Napoleon, quite small. Genghis Khan was a dwarf, eh? But good guys, you know, Lincoln, Kennedy, both six-footers, eh?
Yeah.
Roosevelt, 3'11". Well, he's in a wheelchair.
All right.
Anyway, I'm just saying, you know, Bin Laden is quite tall.
Yeah, how tall is he?
6'3". 7'1", with the hat. So I'm thinking that Bush and Blair might want to wear big, tall hats.
So what's your point?
Well, my point is that there's a new kind of evil.
Yeah.
And it's taller.
In times of war, ladies and gentlemen, you can always count on country music to rise to the occasion. Merle Haggard's recording of The Fight Inside of Me was the number one country song during Vietnam, and now it's once again the most requested song on country music playlists. It would be great to say that we have Merle Haggard here tonight, but we don't.
We blew the wad on the TV.
That's right. So instead, we have a special guest, ladies and gentlemen, always colorful, always outspoken country musician Otis Lee Crenshaw, who happens to be my uncle. No nepotism involved here. He's the only guy that we could get for this show. He is currently in residence at the Brushy Mountain State Prison in Tennessee. Let's talk to him. Otis, how are you?
How am I? I'm in prison. How do you think I'm doing?
What are you in for?
I'm in for a possession of endangered coral. Really don't want to talk about it right now. Who knew it was an animal? Anyway, I got more important things on my mind.
Like what?
Well, I felt as a country music singer, I should try to come up with a song that would sort of whip people into a patriotic fervor and get them up and doing something about this Taliban business.
Yeah.
Not everyone, because most people can't do anything about it, but this is for that small handful of people who can make a difference, and I think you know who I'm talking about, every red-blooded heroin addict out there. As you well know, the Taliban controls all the heroin coming in and out of the country, and so we come up with a little song. It's called Start Kicking That Smack for the Red, White, and Blue. Here we go. You're booted up again. You fell asleep in your shoes. You're a little out of touch with the daily news. Folks call you a moron and your speech is slurred. Well, fella, there's a war on, or haven't you heard? Now, hey there, Mr. Smackhead, where's your patriotism? You're too selfish to see that every time you OD, you're helping terrorism. So start kicking that smack for the red, white, and blue. There's only so much normal folks like us can do. So hey there, Mr. Man, put down that needle. Are those tracks on your arms from a chicken
or an eagle?
Start kicking that smack for the red, white, and blue. Tell that monkey on your back he's got a job to do. Loose lips sink ships and yours are turning blue. So start kicking that smack for the red, white, and blue. One time kicking that smack for the red, white, and blue.
Lee Crenshaw and a couple of his mates from the Brushy Mountain State Prison in Tennessee. Mike, I have a very staggering statistic here.
All righty.
Do you know that the worldwide insurance bill for the September 11 tragedy is 100 billion pounds?
Jesus.
100 billion.
That's a lot of money, sir.
Yes. So you can bet that the cost of insurance is going to rise. And yet, more than ever, people feel the need to have insurance. I, for instance, feel the need to insure my most valuable asset. And I went to Lloyd's of London, and they turned me down. Turned me down flat.
Wow.
They can't afford to insure me or anyone else anymore. I said, Bruce Springsteen insures his voice. You know, Melinda Messenger insured her breast. Why can't I insure, you know, the thing that I make a living at? And they turned me down, and I had to kind of move down the ladder and search for someone to fill in the void.
Really?
This is what happened.
I would like to insure my sense of humor.
Your sense of humor?
Yeah. I'm worried that someday I'm going to wake up and, you know, I won't be funny anymore.
I haven't seen you
right.
on television.
No, I am funny.
I'm sure you are. Yeah. But there's no way anyone, any serious person, would ever contemplate insuring that.
Okay. I might try Florida.
Try anyway.
Yeah.
I'd like to talk to somebody about insuring my sense of humor.
I've been on a lot of shows throughout the world, comedy shows. They think it's all over. Have I got news for you? I've got some reviews right here. These are from Edinburgh Festival. Can I sit here?
I'd rather you sit over there while I read this. So who's Milton Keynes? Some kind of critic?
I played him. Can I? I know this is actually beneath my dignity, and I don't really want to do this, but I think that...
That's great.
If that, you know, helps to convince you. Yeah, I basically like to just insure this car for loss.
Okay, for a loss?
For loss. Okay. Or lose it.
If you lose it?
You know.
I can sell you collision, and that covers if they steal it. But
yeah, that'd be all right. Yeah.
Okay. What kind of vehicle is it?
It's a sense of humor. Essentially, I'm worried that I'm going to end up like, Bob Hope.
Right.
I mean, not senile, but just not funny anymore. You're just sitting here giving me no.
Sorry. No.
Yeah. And you know, I'm doing my best. Do you want me to do stand up for your office? Do you want me to show you right here that I'm still funny?
I'd love that. Right. I'd love to at least get some people laughing.
Look, I want to show you this. Okay. Hi, how are you? Folks, come on in. Come on in here. Hi.
Hi.
How are you? Where are you from, ma'am?
I'm from Seattle.
Yeah. What kind of work do you do? Oh, never mind. You work here, don't you? Great. All right. So, okay. Afghanistan, huh? maybe that didn't. Tough crowd.
Tough. Get covered for you.
Fine.
So.
Okay. I just want you to know that you're not turning me down. I'm turning you down. All right. Okay. Thank you for your time. It's a pleasure.
Thank you. I couldn't do it. Wouldn't insure me. Came back empty-handed. I'd like to take just a moment to explain about our operation here. Most people hear the term think tank, sir. You've heard of a think tank. Do you know what it is? No, you don't, because you haven't thought about it, have you? That's the insidious nature of this. They have to do the thinking for you. Unfortunately, most think tanks are either left-leaning or right-leaning. The Center for Policy Studies, the RAND Corporation, somebody is behind them. They pay them money. They're a bunch of overeducated yes-men, puppets with PhDs. Will not hear. You understand? We answer to no one. We take no contributions. All our money comes from our benefactor, Hunniford Wonder Swift, the man who invented the little yellow juice in the middle of a spirit level. Well, in its heyday, this place had a staff of over 120 and an operating budget of upwards of 16,000 pounds, ladies and gentlemen, but that's all been downscaled a bit. But we are still here, Mike and I, and we're doing the worrying for you. So if you want to get in touch with us, questions, comments, opinions, Mike?
Phone, fax, or anthrax us at Wonderswift House, 0207-331-8901 to fax 0207-331-8902. But remember, ladies and gentlemen, these are fictional numbers.
And that's pretty much it from inside the think tank tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much. We do have a special treat for you. That's right. You like fishing, right, Mike?
As much as the next guy. Man.
Well, you're not alone, Mike, because according to our focus group study, the two main things that television viewers want in this country are celebrity programs and fishing programs, of which there clearly aren't enough. So we thought we'd create a very kind of crowd-pleasing celebrity fishing segment to go out on tonight. You've been a great audience, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for coming. On behalf of Mike Wilmot and myself, we'll see you again.
Okay, Rich, nice to meet you, son.
You like fishing, Bernard?
Well, I can take it or leave it, but...
All right, I'll tell you.
You know what you're doing.
You've been busy lately?
Yeah.
What have you been up to?
Well, I do all the, most of the theatres and just come back from Spain, Tenerife.
Were you working there?
Yeah. I'm a stand-up comedian and the best at my job.
Yeah?
Nowhere they haven't been. 14 weeks at the London Palladium, Royal Command Performances, MGM Grand Las Vegas, my own column in the Sunday Sport, and my own club for 40 years.
So what do you make of all these new comedians? Someone told me Eddie Izzard is one of your favorites.
Who?
Eddie Izzard.
The biggest load of bleeding rubbish I've ever heard in my life. And a puff to boot.
Now?
No, not now, Mike. And what do you make of this whole Afghan situation?
Well, it had to come, didn't it? Can't keep putting up with this terrorism. These people can't go blowing tower blocks up and killing thousands of people. There's no in-between. You've got to kill them. Dead.
All of them? Just blow them all out of existence?
Yep. Woof, 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 and it's all over. In a week, it's all over. Bomb the fuck out of them.
Yeah, they wouldn't know what hit them, would they?
Nope, they certainly wouldn't.
What's your favorite all-time joke?
Two queer cowboys talking. One says, yup. The other says, yep. You say, hey, yeah, hey. You nearly laughed then, Rich. They're going across the car park. She says, I've got an itchy pussy. He says, you'll have to point it out to me, he says, because all these Japanese cars look the fucking same to me. Fuck all in here. Something wrong with this leg that a little bit of dynamite wouldn't put right. Instead of just a wishing.
Sing some more, Bernard. We like it.
America, I love you. You're like a mother to me. From ocean to ocean, for you my devotion is all that I can see. Just like a little baby climbing its mother's knee. America, I love you, and there's 100 million others like me. Thank you very much. I'm the bastard, I'm
up next on BBC Choice, it's Robot Wars.